A local Dubuque nonprofit is working with children to help them cope with the loss of loved ones.
I just knew in my heart that there needed to be something in this community to support kids.
One family's loss of a loved one has inspired them to help others going through similar struggles.
Working through feelings, making sure that they understand that they're not alone.
Their new support group is looking to do just that. That's our top story tonight on LCTV News.
Good evening, I'm Ben Friedman alongside Maggie Wedlake.
Last spring, reporter Amber Krieg told the story of a special foundation here in Dubuque called Live Like Jack. That same foundation is starting a new kind of support group to help grieving children.
So,
Angie Holman sits at her desk, working on her newest project.
I just knew in my heart that there needed to be something in this community to support kids.
The Healing Hearts support group starts in just 2 weeks, and Angie has a vision for helping young ones deal with loss.
Instead of sitting at a table surrounded by everyone else, I wanted them to feel comfortable enough that they had their own comfy chair and their own comfy space and didn't feel like they had to share.
In 2014, Angie's son Jackson passed away suddenly at the age of 8, leaving behind his parents as well as 3 younger sisters. While coping with their loss, Angie's family was often given the same suggestion, therapy.
They didn't need a therapist. They needed to be around other kids who felt the same way, who were going through the same thing or similar.
The lack of options for children's support groups is what sparked the idea for the Healing Hearts support group, a 10-week course that works with kids aged kindergarten through 6th grade to share their experiences and feelings. Psychology professor Dr. Lisa Grindy explained the necessity for such a group.
If they're talking to other kids, they'll probably get some reinforcement and some encouragement that, yep, that's how I felt.
This kind of validation is exactly what Angie looked for when her own kids needed it just 4 short years ago. The group aims to do just that, validate the feelings of its members and live like Jack.
We encourage others to do the same while leading the compassionate life that Jackson led.
The Healing Hearts support group will have 2 separate groups for children aged kindergarten through 2nd grade, as well as 3rd grade through 6th grade that will meet once a month for 10 months.
Earlier today, members of the Loris community gathered to share in a prayer and lament service regarding the abuse scandals in the Catholic Church. The purpose of the event was to pray for both abuse victims and for healing in the church. Feelings of frustration, confusion, and sadness have filled the hearts of many since the news of the scandals. Following the prayer and lament service, a panel discussion and dialogue gave students an opportunity to ask questions and voice their concerns. 4 panelists shared their experiences and their thoughts on how the church and abuse victims can heal from these scandals.
Dubuque residents are feeling more up to speed about what their city has to offer thanks to the annual City Expo last night. Held at the Five Flag Center, almost every department the city has to offer was on display for the public. Residents could sign up for services or simply learn more about everything the city does. The free event gave residents of all ages something to enjoy, including virtual reality games from the library, play areas from the Department of Recreation, and giveaways from a number of booths. Free food was also offered to anyone who came to the event. Dubuque Public Information Officer Randy Gale explains why this event is so important for Dubuquers.
My favorite part about the event is actually getting to have conversations with the residents. They can associate a face with a name and actually have an in-depth conversation about issues that are important to them.
Door prizes and more made this yearly event another success for both the city and its residents.
In just over a week, one of Dubuque's most notable homeless shelters will be back up and running after a 2-month renovation process. I talked to some of the people who know the place best and why the house is so important to them and to Dubuque.
Hope has been restored.
This house needed to hear music again.
The Dubuque Hope House has been closed for the past 2 months.
A lot of people depended on the hospitality here and everything, and it all worked out well.
But in less than 2 weeks, it'll be full of life again. The homeless shelter has been serving the Dubuque community for decades now.
It was ready for some repairs and maintenance and deep cleaning. So we took opportunity to do that this summer, and it's amazing how it looks now.
Mary Moody has been involved with the house since the day it opened.
I was seeking to live both a simpler life and one that involved closer relationship with others.
That includes Thomas, who has dreamed of the day this house would be restored.
When I first came into this house, I was afraid to even sit down on that toilet.
Coming from humble beginnings,
I was homeless at the Dubuque Rescue Mission Shelter.
He was given a chance.
Rick Mims, the director of the Rescue Mission Shelter, approached me with an idea.
That idea was to become the new manager of the place he loves. So when July came, the staff got to work.
We have repainted almost everything entirely.
Cleaned out all the old furniture.
Cleaned carpets, changed over all of the curtains.
It's through its dark period, it's clean, it's fresh.
And for those who care so much about this place,
there's hope, and that's what we're all about.
Hope House grand opening will take place next week, Friday the 28th, from 7 to 9:30 p.m. Thomas and all the Hope House staff want to invite anyone and everyone to come share a meal, sing songs, and celebrate the reopening of this cherished house.
Loris is helping to bring fresh veggies to students and staff thanks to a revamped community garden ran by a group of dedicated workers. The Tom Blacklock Memorial Edible Landscape Garden has started to sprout vegetables for the fall semester. The garden is looked after by LEAF, an acronym standing for the Loris Environmental Action Forum. It's the garden's third year on campus, but it didn't see major use until this year. The garden is named after Tom Blacklock, a 2014 Loris grad who was involved with Loris's sustainability efforts and passed away shortly after graduating. Sustainability intern Cassidy Oberator explains that the campus is always looking for ways to keep a small environmental footprint.
Students and faculty and staff are committed to continuing the sustainable efforts on campus. It's never like you get to a certain point and you stop. It's like, how can we continue to make it sustainable?
Students and staff can swing by and grab fresh veggies at their own leisure.
A Dubuque man has chosen an interesting way to express his school spirit. Reporter Amber Krieg explains how his hobby is making an impact.
Page by page and year by year, one amateur historian is digging deep into the history of Dubuque Senior High School.
If I didn't collect them, who would?
Gary Krieg is an alumni of Dubuque Senior, but many of the memories he has of the school belong to other people. Last year, Gary began collecting yearbooks from his alma mater. During that time, he's gathered nearly 70 books dating as far back as 1913.
It's just really neat looking through all these books how times have changed. You know, that's part of our history. You know, it's never going to be lived again, but it's there in these books.
And though the covers are worn, he's determined to learn the stories of the people featured on these pages.
It feels very important to me because you're keeping this person's name alive a little bit. It's like, I knew these people. You know, I got a little part of them in my book.
Dan Johnson has been the principal of Dubuque Senior for the past 5 years. Though his job is to keep the school moving forward, he sees the importance of looking back.
We are the oldest high school in the area. We are Dubuque Senior High School, and we're the only school that has Dubuque officially in its name, and we represent the entire community. I'm thankful for our amateur historians. I think they're a healthy part of any community.
And for Gary?
It's just an interesting piece of history, what I don't want to see disappear.
It's a role he's happy to fill. Reporting for LCTV News, I'm Amber Krieg.
Gary says that he hopes his collection will inspire more people to get involved with local history. Anyone with unwanted senior yearbooks can donate them to the high school.
Country music and classic paintings were just a few of the topics addressed at this year's National One Act Playwriting Competition. The event kicked off last Thursday right here in Dubuque. For the past year, organizers reviewed more than 100 scripts submitted from across the country. The top three plays were given their world premiere performances as well as feedback from board members and a monetary prize. This marks the 41st year since the contest was first held in Dubuque. Producer Art Roche has been involved with the event for nearly 15 years. For him, the festival is more than a competition.
It's a great honor for Dubuque and probably unrecognized by most of the residents because only the people that appreciate community theater or appreciate playwriting would have a sense of the importance of this.
The Dubuque Fine Arts Players are now accepting script submissions for the 2019 festival.
It's time again for Happy Joe's Trivia. We'll ask the question here, and the first person to tweet us the right answer will be tonight's winner.
Here's your question. How long has the National One Act Playwriting Festival been held in Dubuque? Is it A, 10 years, B, 23 years, or C, 41 years? Send in your guesses, and we'll reveal the winner later in the show.
Coming up after the break, men's tennis hits the court with a home advantage this weekend and comes away with some big results.
And Sports Shorts anchor Ben Burkholder has all the highlights you need from the pitch to the course. Stick around.
Okay, Josh, do your stuff.
Okay, people, you know the drill. Can't do it only, guys.
A message from the Foundation for a Better Life.
Hey everyone, welcome back to Sports Shorts. I'm Ben Burkholder. I have chills just talking right now. Not because of this ice, But due to these Duhawks, let's get to it. The women's soccer team played against the North Central Cardinals in the Rock Bowl yesterday for their third game within 4 days. The Duhawks came to a great start as sophomore Bryn Jacoby scored the first goal within 1 minute of the game. Refs call a foul. What? Allowing for the Cardinals to shoot a penalty kick. But junior goalie Kaylee Coble says, not on my turf, blocking the shot to keep the Cardinals scoreless at the end of the first. Now, I got a question. Kiki, do you love goals? Are you scoring? Yes, she is. In the second half, sophomore Kiki Cabrera scores the second goal of the match. Duhawks clinch this one 2-0.
It's been a crazy weekend, but luckily it's turned out just the way we wanted it. We worked hard. Like, we put in as much effort knowing, like, hey, we'll have a break eventually, but it's been a good work ethic from everybody.
The Duhawks hope to keep their streak alive as they play this Saturday against our hometown rivals at the University of Dubuque Spartans. The Duhawk cross-country team competed in the National Catholic Invitational in Notre Dame this past weekend, which involved teams from all divisions from all across the country. Starting with the men's 5-mile. Coming out of the gate hot, junior Patrick Wallach takes an early jump with junior Tyler Havens not too far behind him. Senior Preston Crowder finishes strong with a time of 26 minutes and 48 seconds. But watch out, senior Cole Cochran Little coming in sprinting into the finish, taking sixth with a time of 26 minutes and 22 seconds. Overall, the Duhawks men's finished second. For the women's 5K, the Duhawks start in a pack and they continue to stay in one throughout the race. These ladies finished 34th, 35th, 36th, and 37th for non-D1 athletes, with the team placing 6th overall. But the story here is freshman Cassie Rosenbaum sprinting across the finish line with a time of 18 minutes and 48 seconds, taking 4th overall, which makes Cole and Cassie your top finishers for the meet. The cross-country team will rally back this Saturday as they compete in the Beloit Old English Invitational at Beloit College. Both men's and women's golf teams traveled to Galena this past weekend, competing at different invites. On the women's side, competing at the Clark Fall invite, senior Anne-Marie Zahn claims a stroke of luck. Day one and tying for 11th. Zahn swings and makes a comeback for day two, placing 5th with a combined score of 171. The team finishes 7th overall at the invite. Moving on to the men's side and competing at the Midwest Classic, Duhawks' Jacob Pizer aids the team with 6 birdies and finishes the invite, placing 36th out of 176 golfers for both days. The men place 14th overall and will be competing at their home invite this weekend at Thunder Hills Country Club. Men's tennis is still going strong in their preseason matches as they hosted the Key City Doubles tournament over the weekend. Just bright and early on Saturday, Duhawks' Riley Mickle and Sean Baldwin take on number 1 Greenville's team. Going in with the ace, the duo takes the dub on one match. But coming up short, Greenville dominates, forcing Mickle and Baldwin to move on to the consolation match, where they take 7th overall. However, they aren't giving up on their final season together.
We got a good group of guys, really deep team, a lot of freshmen coming in, so pretty excited for the next couple weeks. We got conference tournament in 2 weeks.
The Duhawk doubles team standing out so far is Charlie Harris and Trevor Hamilton. Taking on Concordia University's number 1 team, the advantage is theirs, moving up all the way to their final round against Greenville. And, you guessed it, winning it all. The men's team heads on to Waterloo this weekend for the American Rivers Conference individual tournament. And women's volleyball has suffered a loss against one of their toughest opponents yet, the Co-College Cohawks. Attempting to go in hard, junior Kelly Bogie assists the team with 6 kills and 2 blocks throughout the night. But the Cohawks don't back down, as Co's Lindsay Cook dominates an impressive 13 kills that night, along with 12 digs, aiding the team to victory in all 3 matches that night. The Duhawks will travel to Decorah to compete this Saturday against St. Benedictine. Well, that's all I've got for Sports Shorts. It's been real. Back to you, Ben and Maggie.
Thanks, Ben. Don't go away, because coming up, find out why this new wire sculpture holds a deep meaning in one Dubuque community.
And Albrecht Acres hosts Oktoberfest, plus we go live downtown with reporter CJ Ponton. Stay tuned.
Are you ready?
Ready to engineer the technology of today.
And push the limits of tomorrow.
To build the things people need.
Even before they know it.
Ready to discover how the brain works.
And to be at the forefront of a cutting-edge field.
Ready to turn your passion for sports into a lifelong career.
And be the one that really calls the shots.
So, are you ready?
Pursue your passion at Loras College. Check out explore.loras.edu.
Dubuquers might notice a huge new sculpture downtown thanks to the work of some local artists. Rachel Sperling is one of four artists who made Irene, a 14-foot-tall sculpture that depicts a Dubuque Marshallese woman. The sculpture is a response to community concerns about granting healthcare access to the Marshallese in Dubuque. Community members were brought together by the Dubuque Museum of Art to raise awareness about this issue.
And it's a big community in Dubuque, and I think not too many people are aware of the situation that's going on with these people, their culture, and they're trying to kind of keep that going in Dubuque, but they're also facing health impacts and things that are kind of holding them back.
The sculpture reminds members of the Dubuque community of Marshallese presence and the challenges they face with medical care. The artists also hope the sculpture shapes the strong Marshallese culture and heritage in Dubuque. All week, Dubuque Main Street is hosting a Build a Better Block event to showcase the potential of Central Avenue. Reporter CJ Potten brings you there live to get in on the fun.
CJ, what's going on down there?
Hey, what's up, guys? CJ Potten reporting from downtown Dubuque, Iowa, and we are at the Build a Better Block Top Chef Cook-Off 2018. I'm here with Michaela Freiberger. Great name, by the way. Very appropriate. And so, first off, how do you think this event will benefit Build a Better Block?
Sure. So, Build a Better Block is trying to attract the neighborhood to come down and to check out what's going on for the potential of Central. So, essentially, our goal with our streetscape components and filling the storefronts that are vacant right now is to get people down here to kind of say, this is what Central could potentially look like. Now, to partner with that, I've kind of created a robust series of events, and so creating one with chefs and food naturally brings people together to actually try something to eat, which is not something you typically find in Dubuque. And we have some celebrity judges who will be featuring as well.
Awesome. Okay, well, thank you so much for your time. Guys, it is kind of cool out, but things are just heating up down here, so if you can get down here. For LCTV News, I'm CJ Potten. Back to you guys in the studio.
Thanks, CJ. We'll be sure to head on down after the show. Now, Ben, I heard you wore your lederhosen this weekend.
Not only this weekend, I'm wearing it right under the desk right now.
Well, and you would have been just perfect for Oktoberfest. The Dubuque Oktoberfest was held Saturday as a dual celebration and fundraiser for Albright Acres. The camp's a non-for-profit that works with people with disabilities, and the festival was a huge success. Held in A.Y. McDonald Park and in its 10th year running, the festival held events like beer sign holding competitions, wiener dog races, polka dance lessons, face painting, the Dubuque Americana Band, and even the Loras College Jazz Band. The mayor, who was there to support the festival, had these words of hope.
Well, I hope it grows. I mean, it's people that are here are having a great time.
Mayor Buell, along with many others, hopes to help the program by getting the word out more so as to further the benefit.
The event raised over $20,000 for the summer camp.
And the results are in for Happy Joe's Trivia. First, let's recap the question.
How long was the National One-Act Playwriting Festival been held in Dubuque? Is it A, 10 years, B, 23 years, or C, 41 years?
And the answer is C, 41 years. That makes Adrian Pearson our winner tonight. Congratulations and thanks for playing.
And that is all the news we have for you tonight. Be sure to tune in next Wednesday at 6 for another episode of Sports Zone, where we'll also be going live on YouTube. So make sure to follow us on our YouTube page as well. That's Loras College TV.
And don't forget to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter, where we post updates for all of our stories ahead of time. Thanks for joining us. Have a great night.